When I was a teenager, my parents moved to a new town and I had to go to a new school. There was one girl in my class who was really beautiful, and I would have given anything to go out on a date with her. In one of our classes, the teacher paired us up for a project, so we were going to have to spend some time alone together. I figured this was my chance to finally ask her out. We worked on the project at her house, but when I found out where she lived, I began to have second thoughts. She lived in a small wooden cabin in the woods. Her mother wasn't around, and her father really creeped me out. He seemed to be totally insane. He never said a word to me and acted as if I wasn't even there. He walked around the cabin with his shirt off, drinking beer, chewing on tobacco, and carrying a shotgun in his hand. It seemed like the only thing he was interested in was hunting. The walls were lined with bear skins, animal heads, deer antlers, and skulls. It was extremely creepy. At school, one of my friends told me he had heard a rumor about the girl. He said that her father had killed her mother years ago, but the police were never able to prove anything, so he got away with it. Apparently, the mother's body was found in the middle of town, riddled with bullet holes from a shotgun. He said the girl had to stay with her father because she had no other living relatives. The story really rattled me, but there was no way to find out if it was true. I wasn't actually going to come out and ask the girl about it. Eventually, I managed to work up the courage to ask the girl out, and to my surprise, she said yes. It was a date. That night, I drove over to her place to pick her up. She answered the door wearing a short skirt, and she had done her hair and put on makeup. She looked gorgeous. Just as we were about to leave, her father took me aside and spoke to me for the first time. "You know what'll happen to you if you touch her," he growled. Suddenly, the story about him murdering his wife was the only thing I could think about. I took the girl to a movie, and afterwards we went skating. All night, her father's threat was preying on my mind. I was terrified that her dad was going to kill me when we got back to her place. I just couldn't get the thought out of my head. At the end of the night, I drove her back to her place. When we got to her house, she told me to park at the end of her driveway and turn off the headlights. She wanted a kiss. At this point, I managed to forget all about her crazy father. I leaned over and kissed her. Afterwards, I turned the headlights back on, and I noticed something strange. There was blood in the snow at the end of the driveway. At first, I thought I was just seeing things. She didn't seem to notice anything wrong. My heart was beating fast. I wanted to say something, but I didn't want to sound like an idiot. There had to be a logical explanation for all this. I put the car in drive and we started down the long winding driveway to her house. The trail of blood seemed to be getting thicker. I became more and more nervous. She still said nothing. She was fixing her makeup in the mirror. I kept driving, but all I could see was more blood. A chill ran down my spine and I broke out into a cold sweat. I turned the last corner and as we pulled up to her house, the headlights illuminated a figure standing outside. It was her father. He was standing there, covered in blood, and he was clutching a huge knife in his hand. There was something lying at his feet in a pool of blood. It looked like a body. Her father started to approach the car. I completely freaked out and started to hyperventilate. Suddenly, tears were rolling down my face. I'm embarrassed to admit it, but I even peed my pants. I was sure he was going to kill me. As it turned out, he had to drive me to the hospital instead. I was having a full panic attack. I found out later that her father had found a bear at the end of the driveway and shot it. He dragged it to the house and was in the middle of skinning it when we pulled up. I also found out that her mother isn't dead. We are still together. And whenever I meet her father, he always brings up this incident and just laughs at me. This is something that happened to me. And I still have no concrete explanation for it. I lived in Japan for 2 years, way out on the island of Kyushu, in a really rural town. I was teaching English there, and I lived in an apartment complex with 9 other English teachers and a handful of Japanese families. All of our apartments were two-story townhouse style. My apartment was the newest of the bunch. Before me, there had been another English teacher who lived there for 2 years, but before her, as far as I had been told, the apartment had been empty. I first moved in at the beginning of August, which is brutally hot and humid in Japan. It's so humid that the wallpaper in your apartment gets wet and starts to curl up. The only air conditioning in the apartment was downstairs and the bedrooms were upstairs. It was truly unpleasant, and I ended up having to sleep downstairs to avoid the sweltering heat in my bedroom. That is how everything started. One day, I came home from school to find my back door wide open. It was a sliding glass door, and before I left for school, I had securely bolted it. I had locked the front door as well. At first, I thought maybe someone had broken in, but nothing had been taken, and not a single thing was out of place. One of my neighbors came over and looked everywhere with me, but we found nothing strange. At the time, I thought it was no big deal, probably just some curious Japanese kids who thought it would be fun to break in and look at what a foreigner's house was like. That night, I was downstairs, and I just laid down on my futon to go to sleep. All of a sudden, I heard footsteps upstairs. At first, it sounded like someone pacing back and forth between the two bedrooms. Then they suddenly stopped. At this point, I was lying on my futon, shaking and holding my breath. I was terrified that whoever broke in earlier had managed to hide upstairs in the crawl space. After about a minute of silence, I heard an incredibly loud bang, as though something huge and heavy had just fallen and hit the floor above me. I ran right out of my apartment and went to my neighbor's house. I convinced my neighbor to come back with me, and we searched upstairs, but we found nothing. This continued to happen every night, like clockwork. One night, I was at the local bar with one of the other English teachers. He had been living there for 5 years. I started telling him about the strange things that kept happening every night and how I hadn't been able to sleep because of it. "Well, there's a reason for that," he said. "Before you, there was another teacher in that apartment, but before her, the apartment was empty. Nobody would live there because a woman hung herself upstairs after her husband left her. Japanese people wouldn't rent it because they thought the place was cursed, so it was empty until the Board of Education decided to rent it out to foreign teachers. At the time, I thought he was just making up things to try and scare me, but one day, I asked my boss about it. He immediately turned white and said that the other teacher shouldn't be telling me things like that. I tried to press him for more information, but he would neither confirm or deny it. One day, while cleaning my apartment, I noticed something on the underside of the windowsill. Someone had carved the words "try to smile" in Japanese about 10 times. When I saw that, I think my blood literally ran cold. I still don't know what actually happened in that apartment, but every night during the summer, until I would start sleeping upstairs again, those noises happened without fail. My mom's friend is a woman who lives in South Korea. This happened 10 years ago. She lived with her husband and her young daughter in an apartment building in Seoul. At the time, her husband was always at work during the day and her daughter was very young, so she was a stay-at-home mother. One day, the woman went out to run some errands, and she took her daughter with her. When they came back, they stood in the lobby of the apartment building and pressed the button for the elevator. When it arrived and the doors opened, she saw that there was a man already in the elevator. He was wearing a yellow raincoat, and he also had a yellow hat on his head. The woman got onto the elevator with her daughter, and she pressed the button for her floor. Something about the man made her feel uneasy. He never looked up at her. He just kept staring at the floor. It was as if he was keeping his head down so she couldn't really see his face. As the doors closed and the elevator began to ascend, the woman glanced at the man out of the corner of her eye. She noticed that he was carrying something close to his side, something that was wrapped in newspaper. The man was making her nervous. Something about him wasn't right, but she couldn't put her finger on what it was. She made her daughter stand on the other side of her. She didn't know why, but she wanted to place herself in between the man and her daughter. There was an uncomfortable silence as the elevator slowly went up, floor by floor. The woman glanced at the elevator buttons and noticed that only one button was lit up. It was the button for her floor. None of the other numbers had been pressed. Things started to click in her head. That's when she realized what it was about the man that was making her so nervous. He was wearing a raincoat, but it wasn't raining outside. The sun had been shining all day. The woman started to panic. She took out her cell phone, and even though her husband was at work, she pretended she was calling him. She started saying things like, "I'm on the elevator and about to get off. Can you open the front door for me?" and making it seem like her husband was waiting at home for her. When the elevator reached her floor and the doors opened, she quickly grabbed her daughter by the hand and got off. She started to walk as fast as she could down the hallway to her apartment. Glancing back, she noticed that the man had also gotten off the elevator on her floor and was slowly following her down the hallway. When she got to her apartment, she started to bang on the door and said loudly, "Hey, I'm home! Open the door!" She even tried to make it seem as if her husband was coming to answer the door. When the man in the yellow raincoat saw this, he stopped in his tracks, turned around and started to walk back towards the elevator. She watched him until he got back on the elevator, and then she breathed a sigh of relief. She started to punch in the key code to open her door, but her hands were shaking so much, she kept hitting the wrong numbers. Each time she pushed a button, it made a beeping sound. To her horror, she realized that the elevator doors hadn't closed. The man in the yellow raincoat was still there. He could hear the beeps. That meant he knew that no one was going to answer the door for her. She saw him get out of the elevator and come running down the hallway towards her. The woman let out a scream. She tried one more time and managed to punch in the correct key code. The door opened and she pushed her daughter inside. She jumped through the doorway herself, and when she turned around, she saw that the man in the yellow raincoat was right behind her. She just managed to slam the door in his face before he could wedge his hand into the doorway to block her. Her heart was thumping in her chest as she quickly locked the front door and peered through the peephole. She saw the man in the yellow raincoat standing at the door with a knife in his hand. As she watched, he stood there for a moment, then calmly turned and walked back towards the elevator. A few months later, the woman was watching television when a newsflash came on. It said that police had captured a serial killer named Yoo Young Chul. He was responsible for the murders of over 20 young women and old men. After he killed them, he mutilated their bodies and ate parts of them. The woman told my mum that she could never forget the dread she felt when she saw the footage on the news of the serial killer being led away by police. He was still wearing the same yellow raincoat.